All right, everybody, here we are. It is the season two premiere of The Spice. We are in Club Curious, and it is my pleasure to introduce to all of you the one and only lady of The Spice, Regina.
I wanted to be dramatic about it because we've been doing it on Zoom. So I was like, wait, I'm going to wait in the back. And then I almost waited too long. But yeah, I was so excited. I didn't know how to do it. It's so good to see people in person and faces, right? Yeah. Yeah, no, it's true. We don't even know how to react to each other anymore, right? I feel like as human beings, I was in the elevator in my building and there was a guy with his dog. And he was like, say good morning. And I said, good morning. And he said, I was talking to the dog. Like, I feel like, but that's where we are. I don't think we know how to speak. We don't know how to do anything. I had traffic coming here. Traffic is back. Traffic came back with a vengeance. It came back before we came back. And I was thinking I had to text Mickey to be like, oh, I'm like, I'll be there, but I'm on my way. That would have never happened in Zoom Spice. That's all I kept thinking. Like, I'd never be like, Mickey, I'm stuck in my living room. Start the show. My husband would have never blocked off the bedroom and I couldn't get in. But I mean, but here we are. It's so exciting. It's wild. It's wild. It's just good to be here. So I do warm up. I do warm up for the view. And warm up has changed, guys. It's changed. Because in the before times, you would ask people where they were from and people would clap for anything. They'd be like, what is that, a place? Yes! But now we know too much about what's going on everywhere. Do you know what I mean? So I feel like when you're like, oh my God, where are you from? And someone says Charlotte, and everyone's like, Charlotte, is it a hot spot? What's going on over there? What are we thinking? It literally feels like we can't relax anymore as a people. I feel like it's crazy. I don't know what to do. What's, hey guys behind me? Oh my goodness, I see you guys. I like that. Oh my God, I know some of these. It's some of our virtual audience. Oh my God, Julie, Lisa, Colin. Look at you guys. Oh my God. Hey everybody, look at that. We love it. We've got new fans. We've got old fans. We're coming together. This is, guys, am I looking? I love it. I feel like I'm in the future and in real time. It's exciting. So I've been warming up the view with the mask, which has been rough because I also have been doing Invisalign. So with Invisalign plus a mask, I feel like Bane from Batman. That's where I feel like I am, and it's difficult. I'm getting a lot of heat in there. So it feels good. It feels good to be outside again, getting dressed. Everybody, some of us look, we look fantastic. We really do look good over here. You always look this good, don't you? No, come on. No, it's working. It's working. Did you go through a time of not getting dressed up? Were you not going out during this? No, you never stop. Did you? That's the difference. Even at home, you were getting dressed. Right, even at home, I was not doing anything. Just so you know, this is even at home, you were doing that. No, because it's been a rough transition for some of us getting back to our outside clothes, right? Do you guys feel like you forgot how to get dressed? Right, do you know what I mean? I literally put this on, I asked my husband if this looked okay, and I realized my husband was wearing a bandana, a workout shirt, pajama bottoms, and Crocs, right? And I was like, he doesn't know if I look okay, right? Because we've been dressed like we're about to do laundry for a year and a half. Do you know what I mean? So we are it is a difficult time, but we're doing good. It feels good to be out again. I ate a lot of cheese during the quarantine. Anybody else just go to town on cheese? You can clap if you had cheese. I literally, guys, I made a cheese plate every day as if people were coming over. But I was the people. Do you understand? Like, I literally put, I'm like, oh my God, I better get ready for, oh, it's me. I'm eating the cheese. I put all the cheese out there. And it was a bad time because we weren't moving around. You know what I mean? Did you guys bake a lot? Did anybody bake? Did you get sucked into the banana bread? You did. What were you making? What did you do? You did banana bread? Were you nodding? Lemon cake. I like that. What else? What, you made a grapefruit? You were like, I'll use whatever I got in this house. I was like, none of those sound like real recipes, but I love it. You're like, what could I do with this grapefruit? I'll make a cake. Olive oil cake, I feel like I've heard of, but it was a weird time to bake. Do you know what I mean? Because we weren't doing, it was like, why, we're not moving around. It was like a bad time to be like, wait, what could we do to get fat faster? I know, let's bake. That's what I felt. I was like, this is a bad time to be baking, but we did it. Because the only steps I got were to get more cheese, just so everybody knows. If you got each cheese separately, it was like Manchego steps. There we go. That's what I did. I did each cheese separately. Also, I drank a lot, which is why it's good that we're here at Club Curious tonight, because I feel like one thing I did work on was my tolerance. Was that anybody else? Did anybody else feel like, yeah, everyone just looks around like, I don't think it was me, but it was me. It's true, right? I feel like, you know, I mean, I know Mickey knows because we spend a lot of this together. Yeah, no, it's literally, I could be like, guys, I'm totally wasted right now. And you would never know. And it started out cute, like me and the husband. You guys are flat. Do you understand? Listen, you're like, then what a perfect time. Could you hold it up so that, may I hold it up so that people could see? Do you guys, this is where we are, just so everybody knows. This is a member of an audience. I appreciate it. Oh my God, I love it. Perfect. Well, okay, so it says, leave it to Gibbo. So far, it's going pretty good. Yes. Is there a mystery in here? Or there's a mystery on here? Okay. This mystery is in like three different spots, which is amazing. Oh my goodness, I love it. Do you know about this? You've seen this. It was a birthday gift for your wife. And then you took it. Oh, from. I was going to say. You're like, it's my wife's. I have a problem. Okay, and then you took it, which would be fine, too. I love. So. My wife is the one with the problem. She doesn't drink. Just so, right, because we want to go down together. Well, you've got us now. We're in this together. Right, we're in this together. Because it started out, I feel like, cute at the beginning. We would open a bottle of wine at night, my husband and I, you know, I would pour a glass, I'd pour him a glass. He'd go to pour a second glass, and he'd be like, oh my God, is it empty? And I'm like, we must have finished it. But I finished it every time. That's what happened, guys. And then towards the end, I would just pour the whole bottle and make aggressive eye contact with him because I didn't care. Turn around and look at the bell. Look. Good, perfect timing, Sean. Oh my God, hey, you guys, so good. It was just... It's so funny. It's like being between two, but they can see me this way. But then if I go this way, do they see my back? Oh no, there's another camera. This is insane. This room is totally rigged. Wait, a fan? Mickey, I'm looking at a fan. I feel like this is the wrong. I was like the Vornado, played at the Vornado. Wait, why? That's a camera? That looks like, I don't even know what that looks like. That's crazy. Did you guys know that's a camera? The technology in this room is blowing my mind. You'd think there was alcohol in the drinks, to be honest. Because I'm like, that's a camera? This is insane. Oh my God, this is great. It's kind of fun to look everywhere, though, in all different places. And just to work, and then my dress is moving. Guys, I'm having more fun by myself, just so everybody knows. But I'm like, I'm out of the house. Yes. Just also, I want you guys to know, I used to do this from our one-bedroom apartment. My husband and I are in a one-bedroom apartment, so the other room is a bathroom. I feel like most of you guys know about a one-bedroom apartment. So literally, I'd be doing the Spice, and my husband would text me, and I would think it would be like a cute, like, good luck text, have fun at the Spice, say hi to Mickey, and in all caps, he'd be like, shut up! That's what he was doing. And then under it, Mickey, he would put three angry faces. So like, I didn't think it was that cute, like, shut up. It was like, shut up. And then it's funny. Now that I'm out of the house, he's like, we have cement walls. And it felt like you were always screaming in my face. And it was crazy. And all these people know back here, the virtual audience, I would also do The View same time on Zoom. And I'd be like to my husband, you'd never believe what happened. He'd be like, I know everything that happened. You're screaming all the time. So when I finished... After the last Spice, my husband clapped when he knew this was the last one at home. Not for the Spice, for being like, please leave the apartment. So it's good to be separate. It's good, a little bit. Now, you guys look very cozy. How long have you guys been together over here? 1 month. You guys, this is why, no wonder. 4 months. Oh, you've been four months, 1 month. That's the beginning. You can tell. Let's see. I feel like my husband dropped me off. He won't even pick me up. That's where we are now. But this is like, look, 4 months. They're like, we'll take the love seat. We got this. Everyone else is struggling. This is perfect. Oh, how did you guys meet? You dated in 95? Okay, listen. That was a long callback. I feel like you're like, all right, they'll call. He'll go. It took 26 years. He was like, maybe tomorrow I'll call. Maybe tomorrow I'll call. And so 26 years, and you're like, wait, I'm doing it. And then you just the whole time, you're like, he's going to call. He's going to call. How good did you feel when your friends were like, he's not going to call? Then you're like, guess what, everybody? He called. And then you're like, what, 26 years? You were right. That's amazing. Look at that. You got to wait sometimes. Put the time in. You put the time in, and it all worked out. So you're a thinker. It took you 26 years. You were just sitting there thinking, I love it. And how did you meet that first time? College friends. Okay, perfect. Took a little time for yourself. And now it's, You have the same. So all these friends have been also waiting 26 years. So a lot of people are involved in this. This was a big thing. But now we're together. Oh, my God. Well, that's fantastic. And it's going strong. Month four. We let. So. Well, you've already waited long enough. It is what it is now. Do you know what I mean? Listen, at this point, let's make it work. Is anybody together for more than 4 months? What's anybody in here? Look at you. Oh, yeah. How? I have, look, oh, I wish you guys could see. Oh, yeah, as he's undoing the flask again. I'm like, how long have you been? Oh, longer than 4 months. Long, he's like, flask for me, flask for glass. Flask for me, flask for glass. Yeah, it's longer. how long has it been for you guys? It's an average. It's an average, guys. We'll get there. When you get to a certain, it's true. I used to always think those people that like kind of didn't remember how long ago their anniversary was, I'm like, they're crazy. But I'm that person now, right? Because you're like, it was, what year was that? And then, right? Do you feel like the same way, Mickey? You guys, because we're like the same amount of time.
When I turned 30. And that was 12 years ago.
Yeah, no, that's another thing. I don't know how old I am. Do you ever use a machine at the gym? Okay, I'm going to say machine at the gym. I don't even know the last time I used a machine at the gym, so everybody knows. But whenever that was, I remember putting my age in. I'm like, wait, what is my age? You get to a certain point and you don't even know what your age is anymore. Do you guys feel that way? You guys are very cute on the couch, but do you guys all know each other? Or you're just like, let's basically sit on laps? Okay, you do. No, because they are close. Look at like 4 months. It's like, we'll take the whole thing. We're spreading out. And you guys are like, I'll be with you. I'll be with you. And I can, are you guys? Who is with who? It doesn't even matter. You're together. But it looks like you're with her. Do you see what happened here? You guys, when you're at the Spice, you're with everybody at the Spice. You know what I mean? You mix up your couch. You figure up your relationship. Oh, my God, the camera just moved. It's so cool. Wherever, guys, isn't technology great? It is. It's blowing my mind. Oh, my goodness. You guys, well, this is okay. Now, how long have you guys been together on the end? Okay, good. 14 years, which is why he's with her right now, which is what happened. When you get to 14 years, you're like, I'll take who's ever there. But oh my God, I'm feeling like this is the first time, you guys, I get to throw to Mickey in person. Is this crazy, Mickey? It's crazy, because normally we're on Zoom. I'm like, can you see me? Can I see you? Right? This is wild. Okay, so we're coming to the stage. Coming to the stage? I don't even know what to say. I'm blowing my mind. DJ Mickey D?
DJ Mickey D, give me your intro, Regina. Throw it to me.
Wait, oh my God, you guys, wait. I don't even remember how to do it anymore. That's been so crazy. Oh my God, you guys, so it's time. I'm going to throw it over to DJ. What would I say? Mickey, whisper to me.
I'm going to say, and now. For the season 2 premiere of the Spice.
Guys, I got so excited. I got so excited, I even forgot what we were doing here.
I forgot
Imagine
your
Kiku
last
never
name.
Comes out, because I'm like, guys, so anyway, more about me. And then Kiku's like, Regina, this is my night. And I'm like, guys, this is so much fun. Follow me with more cameras. All right, you guys, it's a season 2 premiere of the Spice. And it is time for me to bring to the stage DJ Mickey D.
Oh, yeah.
In person. In person.
Thank you so much, Regina. It's so good to see you. And I'm so happy that you're here with us again, season 2. You're live. We're live.
We're
all live and in person. Once we walk out this door, we'll put our masks back on. But, you know, that's how it goes. In the comforts of Club Curious, we're all friends. We're all part of the
We sure are.
Feast
of
friends.
Yeah. We should have to go pick a couple to be a part of.
I know a good couple to line you up with. All right, Gina,
perfect.
My darling, if you have a seat, we're going to get the show rolling.
Yes.
Right over there for you, darling.
Oh, perfect. I'm going.
All right. Here we go. And yep, that's just fine right there. All right. It is official. Here we go. The season 2 premiere of The Spice. I am DJ Mickey D, and I could not be happier to be back with the Good Vibes Machine in this incredible feast of friends we have here tonight. You can see things are a little bit different this year, and we do have a virtual club that we're coming from. Club Curious is a club that was created by Curious Elixirs, and they opened up the door for us to stream live. So here we are. The one thing that hasn't changed about The Spice is what we do on The Spice. We tell stories and we share memories that remind us all of how important music is to our lives. My friend Kiku Collins, she's going to be the first selector on the Spice Season 2. Kiku grew up in New Jersey, and she knew from a very young age that she had bigger and better callings for her life. So she packed up her bags and moved to the big city. And before long, she would become the world-renowned ninja princess. And she just has an incredible story to tell. So without further ado, I would like to introduce to you the one and only Kiku Collins. There she is.
Hi.
How are you, Kiku?
Doing okay. How are you?
I'm so good. I'm so happy to have you here.
Yay.
You know, like, I have a little bit of an anxiety, so you know I'm excited when I start, like, when I say hi, I do a little shimmy.
Uh-oh. Yeah. That's just choreography.
Choreography, that's right. I'm so happy to have you here with us tonight, Kiku. What are you drinking? Oh, you're drinking water.
I'm drinking water.
I am drinking a Curious Elixir number two.
Very curious. Number two.
So, Kiku, if it's cool with you, we're going to jump right into this.
Ooh, okay.
All right. So, for you chose the song, this encompasses the ninja princess spirit. And it is Hit Me With Your Best Shot by Pat Benatar. So Kiku, like all great nicknames, they're bestowed upon you at a seemingly random moment in time, and then they grow to really encompass you. So tell us about the tour you were on when you were given the nickname Ninja Princess and how it's come to really just encompass you.
Well, it was a long time ago. It must have been about five. it was a very long time ago. And I walked onto a tour bus. We were doing some gigs with this. I was with this blues band. There was another band that we were, you know, kind of playing alongside. And I walked on, and all of a sudden I heard, oh, we got a real live ninja princess on the bus. And I thought, wait, what? I'm just trying to get my bags on here. What's going on? And it just immediately stuck. And it was fun because the person who said it to me, his wife was Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, he starts speaking Japanese to me. I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I'm like level one, okay? Let's take it way down. Exactly. I was just like, I mean, I know some. And they just immediately started introducing me as the Ninja Princess on that tour. And so it just, I mean, it there was no grace period. It just stuck immediately.
So it stuck, and now you have a Ninja Princess tattoo.
Yeah.
So tell us how just the seemingly random nickname that was given to you really, really became part of your character. When I say character, I mean like your character as a person, not like a character that you play on stage. But
I do that too.
Your true character.
Maybe I'm very sneaky.
Yes.
I think people don't always expect me when they see me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like when I walk into a room and, you know, I'm going to a gig and I'm always asked, are you one of our singers? You know, or are you playing piano? And it's just like, could you stereotype
Neither.
Me more?
Right.
Hold on, let me get my calculator out for you. I mean, what do you want from me? So, I mean, I guess people never expect me to be the trumpet player.
Mm-hmm.
And there's always a lot of surprise. So I guess it's kind of my little ninja sneak attack.
There you go. The ninja sneak attack. I like it. It's a great nickname. It really is. I love it. Okay, we're moving on to song number two.
Mm.
Song number two is TNT by AC/DC. Let's give it a little bit of a listen. If it would play. Nope. here. So we have a lot of cool stuff that's going up on that wall. So back to our interview.
Mm-hmm.
When Kiku, when you and I met, it was on stage at NJPAC and you were performing at the Black Girls Rock Show.
Yeah.
I was there working audio and I came over to hand you your in-ear monitor pack.
Uh-huh.
You looked at me and said, "You have a cleft lip." And
that's something I would say.
It was, yeah. And it was, usually I would be taken aback, but you had such kindness and familiarity in your voice that I was just like, okay, I'm going to see where this goes. Uh-huh. And then I went and looked you up and figured out that we were part of the Holodelic family.
Uh-huh.
So after that, we just bonded. But tell me about why you chose this song to represent your daughter, T. And tell me about her journey being born with a cleft lip and cleft palate.
Well, I mean, her initials are TNT.
Okay, there you go.
That was not by accident. and, you know, when I was pregnant, the 3D sonogram saw her cleft. And so I spent basically my second and third trimester looking for surgeons and trying to figure everything out. I was ready to move to wherever I had to be in the world. Have looked up, but I didn't. But I'm still associated with them.
Sure.
I haven't, you know, ever since things got crazy with my career, I haven't had time to do as much. But I still talk to families, and I still kind of help people figure their path.
Sure.
To helping their children or if they're adults with a cleft or other craniofacial condition. It was very unexpected. I guess nobody expects it.
Sure.
But it also, I met a lot of people along the way, and I learned a lot about different craniofacial conditions and different, you know, different methods. And, you know, our team was very forward thinking, you know, that insurance wouldn't even think about covering anything because it was like, oh, but that's experimental.
Mm-hmm.
And they were so amazing that I just said, what else would I do for my kid?
That is incredible. When I was a child, I had a single mother, and we would have to go every year down to Sunnyview, and they would examine us to get funding.
Mm-hmm.
And that was one of the things I remember throughout my life. That was one of the hardest things to do, to go to be in a room with all other kids.
Yeah.
And then to get examined. And it's like, mm-hmm. But you know, you have to do what you have to do.
Right, right. Yeah, no.
Well, moving on to song number 3, we have The Scythe by your husband, David Gibson. Let's give a little listen. I love this, the horns at the top. So Kiku, my wife Maribeth, who is here tonight,
so cute.
Her favorite story to tell is the story of how we met.
Mm-hmm.
So I am opening the floor to you with the scythe playing in the background. This is the song that reminds you of David. So tell everyone, the millions of people watching around the world, the story of how you and David met.
He usually tells the story, but I guess I'm here now. So basically, we have a mutual friend in the business, and everyone assumes that we met on a gig, but we actually never crossed paths.
Bring this mic a little closer to you,
yeah,
Kiku.
I know. I'm so quiet. So yeah, we have a mutual friend in the music business, and I guess, you know, he was talking to David and brought me up and said, "Oh, do you know Kiku?" And he was like, "Well, I know of her." And he said, "Well, you guys should really meet because, you know, you're both, you know, you have daughters and blah, blah, blah." I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
It was just, that sound right? That sounds right. He tells it and it takes so much longer, so I'm like, I missed 1,000 things. It's still early.
We have some nice pictures of you and David.
That was a pandemic gig. That was online. Oh, that's perfect. So
you guys look like you have a lot of fun together.
Yeah, we do. I mean, what are we gonna do, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, so I was doing a lecture and performing at this trumpet event. I call them like trumpet dork conventions.
All right.
And I actually didn't even want to do it, but they kept asking me, and I said, ugh, fine, I'll just do it. And so when I was done, I was in the hallway and talking to people that were, you know, that were there. And then apparently David was playing with some trumpet player, and they came out and he saw me and he recognized me and he said, okay, I'm gonna go talk to her because Steve keeps talking about her and blah, blah, blah. And he said that he stood there for an uncomfortable amount of time, and he had to give up because it was starting to get a little creepy.
Yeah, the little clinger,
yeah,
action.
Yeah,
stage one
little,
clinger, you don't even know.
Little weird,
him.
Yeah, little weird. So then Facebook was still pretty new, and I probably had like 6 friends. And he sent me a message on Facebook, and it's kind of a miracle that I even opened it because I was, you know, all in my space, you know. All, you know. I guess I'm dating us, basically. So we're really old.
I had a completely customized MySpace as well.
Woo!
So
man, I even have a fictitious band on there, but that's another story for another day. So he sent me a message, and he said, you know, Steve speaks highly of you, blah, 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 blah. I saw you at the trumpet thingy, and, you know, you were really busy talking to people, so whatever. It was more eloquent. And,
That's right.
Right. So I did. I wrote back and I said, "Why did they let a trombone player into a trumpet convention?" Something like that, you know. And that was my usual kind of snark.
Yeah.
And so I guess we became Facebook friends, but we didn't talk for another 2 years.
All right.
And so after 2 years of cyber stalking me, he sent me a message. And
it's better in 26 years, yeah, like these guys.
That's
over
true.
Here.
Man, you guys gotta move it. time's a wasting. So, you know, he sent me a message and he said something like, you know, I think you help a lot of people with what you write. And I was like, okay, who is this dude again? Oh, that's the stalker. No. So we just started this dialogue, and immediately, I was really impressed that he wrote in complete sentences.
Mm-hmm.
He had, you know, his spelling and grammar were in check. He didn't try to talk about, right, he didn't try to, like, talk about how I looked.
Just that, a friendly conversation between,
yeah,
musicians.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And so we're going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And finally, it was like, well, you know, I think you said it, right? We should just meet up or something. So we met up for a cup of coffee. And the rest is history.
The rest is history. I like it. That's a good story. That's a good story. Moving on to our next song. We actually don't have a song.
Uh-oh.
This is the first time in the very long and storied history of The Spice that we do not have a song for a segment.
I broke the rules.
You did. And that is, the question that I asked you was, what song inspired you to play the trumpet? And then I learned, well, your answer was none. And then watching an interview, I learned that you grew up in a household and your older brother was playing the trumpet. And mm-hmm. when you were in fourth grade, you had to choose an instrument to play. And the only instrument you had available to you to play was the trumpet because your brother played.
Yep.
And then you took a test, you aced that test, and you realize that the years that you had been watching your brother play at home, you were putting in work learning how to play.
Yeah.
So the trumpet kind of chose you out of necessity. At what point did you fall in love with playing the trumpet?
I think it happened kind of quickly, because, you know, of course I was told back way, way back in the day, you know, music teachers would tell girls, don't play the trumpet,
mm-hmm.
because you're a girl. And so I think, you know, very quickly I realized that I had taken in a lot of information just from watching my brother. And then, you know, and I'm a very stubborn person. And so I figured, well, if I'm stuck with this thing, I might as well learn how to make it work. And
mm-hmm.
I think it was only a requirement to play for a year, and I was like, ah, I'll get through the year and blah, blah, blah. And I just started kicking butt. I was like, oh, this is fun because I'm not supposed to play it.
Yeah.
And I'm actually doing okay.
So a little bit of a rebel spirit.
Yeah. There's a lot of that going on.
Awesome.
I get it from my mom.
Yeah. I like to say I never met a law I didn't like to break.
There you go. And that's how you learn how to play the trumpet.
There you go.
Take notes, kids.
Absolutely. So moving on. So fast forward into your life. You are a musician. You're a working musician. And the first record that you ever recorded right here is Mr. Barista by Kiku Collins. So Kiku, paint the scene for us. You're in the studio. Engineers are there. Band's there. You're getting, this is on your record, and you're getting ready to lay it down. So tell us how you're feeling, paint the scene, just give us the experience of being in the studio, getting ready to record your first recording as an adult, as a working musician.
Well, I was going through a real dark time in my life, and I had no real intention of making a record. I never thought I would. I mean, I was a studio musician for so long, and I was very happy doing that, you know, just playing little jingles and whatever for whoever wanted, and you know, roll in my pajamas and roll out, and nobody knew who the heck it was, and they'd be like, oh, I heard that Whisk commercial. It's like, yeah, that was me. You know, I'm selling detergent. So but my, you know, my situation was really difficult at that time.
Okay.
And I just honestly I needed to get out of the house. So I was actually at Staples maybe printing up flyers for a band I was in, and someone's in line, and you know, he's like, oh, what is, are you in a band? I was like, yeah, that's what these band flyers are for. And because this is back in the day when we had flyers, people.
Oh yeah.
And and he introduced himself, and it turned out that he had a studio, and you know, he also worked in the whole jingle vibe and the commercials and stuff, and we knew a lot of people in common. He was like, oh, this is great, you know, and you know, he took my information, was like, all right, you know, if I ever need a trumpet player, I'd love to call you up, blah, blah, blah.
Sure.
And as time went on, you know, I would come in and do little things for him, and we just, he was like, why don't you do a record? This is crazy. I mean, you know, you play trumpet, flugelhorn, valve trombone, why aren't you doing something? I was like, I don't know, it's not really what I do. And so we just started writing, and I remember writing this. I was in a really, really, really angry mode that day.
Yeah.
And so it's funny because it's so upbeat, but it's also really dark.
Do you hear your anger in the way you're playing the trumpet?
Totally do. And the trombones, too.
Yeah.
I especially hear the trombones. I was, like, really mad. I remember being really angry and finishing this, and I was like, oh, it was like therapy. It's like, I feel kind of better. But, you know, it's funny because at the end of the tune, it doesn't really resolve. So,
right.
Which is something I like to do because nothing's over.
Yeah,
nothing's
right?
ever over.
Leave it open for the next chapter.
That's right. That's
Speaking
right.
of the next chapter, that was a nice little segue right there. If I do say so myself, and I do say so. we're going to play in the next song we have is The Messenger by Kiku Collins. And this is the favorite song that you've ever written.
Yeah.
So tell me about your inspiration for writing this song, and what was the catalyst for this song becoming the favorite song you've ever written?
Well, this was inspired by TNT.
Okay.
So, I just always felt like no matter how bad things were, I had this little baby.
Yeah.
And I was just like, man, you know, like, she's just always there for me.
Yeah.
And so she was my little messenger.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. It's a beautiful story.
Yeah.
Short and sweet.
I know, right?
I like it. I like it. So we can move on to the next one. So we've been talking about some uplifting and happy subjects here, and now we're going to talk about an experience that we've all shared over the past year, and the song that represents how you felt during the pandemic, or at the beginning of the pandemic, is Gloomy Sunday by Big Maybelle. So let's give a listen.
Thank you. darling, I hope that my dreams ain't never haunted you. My heart was just telling you how much that I wanted you. Gloomy, gloomy Sunday.
I also have a version of this song that is going to play under our conversation, and that's by the John Griffin Orchestra. So when the pandemic hit, I have like this theory that it is the first time everyone who is alive on Earth is experiencing the same thing for the first time. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know there's a handful of people that were around in 1918, but you know, I'm kind of not including those people. But I remember when the pandemic started to hit, like a gig went away and then two gigs went away. And then there was that tidal wave that came through. Mm-hmm. And it was like what I call the empty calendar syndrome. When you're first starting to be a freelancer, you just have to trust that the calendar is going to fill up. Yeah. The calendar was empty.
Yeah.
So tell us, how did you adapt and how did you make your way through to where we are now?
I mean, I don't know, honestly, how I made it through. And we're still in it, so.
Yes, we are.
It's weird. I just remember that, you know, because my husband and I, we were so busy, and we, our calendars, and we share a calendar, it is just jam-packed where it gets confusing looking at the calendar.
Sure.
To figure out where we're supposed to be. And all of a sudden, we just kept deleting stuff. And then all of a sudden there was nothing. It's like, you know, is this the Twilight Zone? What is going on?
Right.
And it was really hard because, you know, everything was closed. So, you know, we would go for little family walks and like, oh, there's a supermarket. It's open. Whoa. You know,
yep.
And it was just like we were in some kind of post-apocalyptic kind of a vibe, and,
mm-hmm.
you know, like there's gonna be zombies walking around, and it was crazy. And at night, we would sometimes go to our neighbor Joni's and go to her balcony and just sit there, and we would just look out. There'd be no traffic, and you
just
know,
a
we
quiet city.
Yeah, and we live in a busy part of town. We're going, this doesn't even make sense. Like, I can't even make sense of any of this.
Mm-hmm.
And it just felt like Groundhog Day.
Every day.
Oh my, it's like, okay, so how do I motivate myself to practice?
How did you?
I mean, I kind of made a deal with myself.
Yeah.
I was like, well, I mean, you know, I have to practice every day and I have to exercise. How am I going to get this done? And practicing wasn't as hard. Because, you know, we have a studio and it was, you know, the three of us are in the apartment 24/7 now. So, you know, it's this tiny little room that is kind of, you know, we call it the cave sometimes.
Sure.
And so it was nice just to go in there and to feel like, okay, I'm doing something. This is for me and I'm going to get better. And also, you know, once in a while, some kind of a recording gig would come through or someone would say, oh, I want you to do a video recording and we're going to put the band all together, you know, like a little Brady Bunch thing. And so, you know, honestly, that was one of the things that kept me going was like, ooh, someone might call me and I won't be able to play.
Right.
That's scary because how can I turn down a gig? You know, I went from like 1,000 gigs to zero.
Right.
If I get one gig, I'm keeping it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it was a lot of talking to myself about that.
Sure.
Saying I can't let this go. Everybody's
sure.
going through this. And, you know, I mean, it's just like if you're on tour and you go home for a week, you don't put your horn down.
Right.
Because
you may not unpack your luggage.
Right. Oh, yeah. No. That stays closed.
Right.
And you don't want to know what's in there. But the horn comes out immediately because someone might call you for a gig. Someone might say, hey, can you record this really quick for me? And you have to be ready. You can't let your guard down. So it was really thinking about that that kept me going to the studio every day.
Sure.
And saying, I can't let it go.
And we talked a bit about, before the show, we talked about the change in mindset. the change in going from I gotta take the gig, I gotta make the dough, gig to gig to gig, to maybe that's not the life anymore. Maybe I cut back a little bit and now I'm spending more time with my family, friends, doing things that are not work related, and maybe that translates into enjoying the music a little bit more.
Right. Yeah. I mean, David and I were doing that before the pandemic, but it really hit hard after being home and gigless for so long, where, you know, you'd get a call and you'd say, I don't really like these people, I don't like this music, and I don't like thinking about going there, and if I accept this gig, I can't just do it because I need the check.
Right.
And so if I take this gig, I'm not allowed to be mad. I'm not allowed to be cranky about it. I have to have a good time. If I can't do that, I can't take the gig.
Right.
And that's it. That's the bottom line. I'm not going to be miserable.
Right.
You know, we've all been miserable for so long that if I'm going to go play this horn, I'm going to have fun.
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing fun about doing a gig and then getting on a plane, you know, after 3 hours sleep, going to the next. And, you know, there is a lot of fun being able to work in the music world, either, you know, on the tech side or on the instrument side, the musician side. But it's such a grind.
Yeah.
It's
exhausting. And people don't see that. People just see, like,
on stage, the lights.
Yeah, they're like, oh, it's so glamorous. It's like, are you kidding me? My eyelashes were falling off. My wig is tugging at my scalp. And I got 2 hours of sleep.
Yeah.
And I wanted to throw up the entire time. But I'm so glad that you enjoyed it.
Yes.
Because that means that I did my job.
Yes, absolutely.
But I would rather have fun with you.
Yes.
You know, and so that's the deal now.
That is the deal. We're going to move on to our next question. But before then, I'm going to let everyone know in the virtual audience that if you would like to ask Kiku a question, just send Maribeth a text in the Zoom. If you have a good question, you'll get through and you'll be up on the virtual wall and you'll be able to talk to Kiku. So moving on to our next song, we have a little bit of a song from a woman who means so much to you, I Will Survive by Gloria Gaynor. All right, Kiku. So you were diagnosed with cancer 9 years ago.
Yep.
And you've been an incredible advocate for people living with cancer. On a personal note, my father passed from cancer this past February.
Oh, no.
And I've always appreciated your perspective, and that it's just a real perspective on a real situation. I was there with him. It wasn't fun. It wasn't pretty. And it was very sad and painful. And as you say, there was no ass to kick.
Yep.
And so I really appreciate the perspective that you have. And it was on my mind a lot when I was there taking care of my dad.
Aww.
And I was happy that I was able to do that. So if you could share with us why this song, I Will Survive, even though it could be a little obvious. Why this means so much to you, and tell us how your journey living with cancer has helped you or prepared you or just been a tool for you to get through the trials and tribulations of life.
Well, so I played my first gig with Gloria a month before David and I got married, and then a month after we got married I was diagnosed. So It was kind of creepy, actually, that, you know, I started playing for the woman who basically has this anthem for, it seems like, every cancer patient everywhere.
Sure.
I don't know. I mean, it seems like this is everyone's theme song. And, you know, I kept it very quiet for maybe 9 months. Because, you know, the music business is brutal.
Yeah.
And people will come out of the woodwork and, you know, kind of figure out who to talk to about your gig.
Yeah, they're like, gig stars.
Yeah. Oh, it's disgusting.
Gig poaching.
Yes, totally. Yes. And I've seen it happen to other people.
For sure.
And I said, I'm not telling anybody until I know I'm through enough of it. And I wasn't even halfway through my treatment when I came out of the cancer closet. But, I mean, you know, it's amazing because all those months where I hadn't been telling people, there were very few people that knew. And so, I don't know how I weaseled my way through a major surgery. I didn't play for 3 months. You know, a lot went on that I was able to keep quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, part of it was I had taped some TV shows that aired while I was recovering.
Okay.
So that really helped because people just believe what they see.
Right, yeah, you're out there performing right now.
Yeah, they're like, oh my gosh, this is great, I see you. I'm like, I'm at home and I've got these bloody drains hanging out of me and I can't move. But, you know, it helped kind of keep that appearance together. And then, you know, I'm still in the cancer closet and I'm going on tour with Gloria Gaynor of all the people. And I'm playing I Will Survive every night. And I'm like, oh, this is kind of deep. Like, you know, and honestly, like, if you've ever gone to a Gloria show, it is just nonstop happiness.
I believe
it. It's just nonstop. It's amazing. And even, like, for us in her band, it's just, we have such a good time because everybody's so dedicated, first of all, to putting on a great show. So we all learn our music. We all learn our dance steps. We all get along. And she's very good at, she and Stephanie are really good at you know, curating this band that feels like family.
Sure.
And so, you know, going around, of course, you know, I would go to my hotel room and be like, I'm going to die. This is it. But knowing that I was out with my road family and playing this song that gives so many people hope, I was like, wait a minute, maybe I'm not going to die yet.
Yeah.
You know, and so I would get up the next day and I would play I Will Survive in a New City and, you know, see all these amazing fans out there and have a great time and nobody knows that I have got this water balloon inside of me right now and that I'm hemorrhaging and, you know.
It's intense.
Yeah, or, you know, like when I went through radiation, it's disgusting. I mean, if you've ever known anybody who's gone through radiation, it's horrible. It's like you've been in a fire and you were in the middle of the fire. And then you're up on stage dancing and every bead of sweat is just burning you like it's acid. But you're just going on. You're like, hey, I'm having a great time. Ow, this really hurts.
A testament to how much you love playing.
Maybe. Yeah, I guess
mean, do you think
so?
You would get through it if you didn't really love what you were doing?
Yeah, you got a point there.
Right.
I mean, I always think that it's my stubbornness, but I wouldn't get through everything like that.
No.
So you're right. I would not run a marathon. I do not enjoy running long distances.
I believe it.
So
I can run a marathon on a treadmill.
Yeah, no. Right. Now, even then, I get bored. I mean, how much Netflix can you watch?
Yeah, right.
So, yeah, I mean, you're right. You know, I do. I think the thing that I love about being a musician and making music is I like making people happy.
Sure.
And so that's my
job. You're
in
the right business.
Yeah, no doubt. But it doesn't matter how I feel at that moment. I'm just like, but I'm working and I'm here working for this audience and for the artist and for the band members and, you know, and so I need to do my job.
Mm-hmm.
And in turn, it ends up making me happy.
It's a nice cycle.
It is.
It is a nice cycle.
Yep.
On to the next song. And again, Kiku had a non-answer for this question, but I think it's a really good question to ask. I asked Kiku what song represented when she had become a professional musician. What song was that moment? And she said, I don't know if I'm a professional. So my volley back to you is, what defines success for you?
Yeah, I'm success to me is different than being a professional. You know, I mean, I hear professional and, you know, I think, oh, well, gee, I should have been a lawyer if I wanted to be a professional, you know.
Or yeah, my lawyer best friend right there.
Oh, yay! Congratulations on being professional. I didn't do it. but success is totally different to me. Success is taking what you do and learning to love it and learning how to love it no matter how many times you do it.
Yeah.
You know, and my family hears me in the studio every morning doing the same boring warm-ups and just, you know, sounding terrible and, you know, playing things that I can't play in order to learn how to play them.
Sure.
And you really need to love what you're doing in order to keep coming back for that torture.
Absolutely.
Because, I mean, how many people really want to wake up in the morning and immediately just start making these horrible noises and
that's you,
yeah, right.
Another day, 4:30.
But you know, like the whole trying to wake my face up, oh man, my chops aren't responding and blah blah blah, mm-hmm. my aperture's not closing enough, and you know, all the dorky things that brass players all the dorky things we go through. I go through this every day. Every day, and I do these exercises and I look stupid and you know, but at the end, I want to sound good, and I want it to feel good to do, mm-hmm. and it doesn't always feel that way.
I believe it.
So to keep right, see, I think that's why we're married, because we're like, yeah, it really sucks.
The yin and the yang.
I'm telling you, but it's true. It's like you really need to. You get to a certain point, and you really need to love playing this crazy looking thing.
Sure.
You need to, because there's no other reason to do it.
It's kind of like the pleasure pain balance.
Kind of, yeah. You know, yeah, it's like working out.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you want the end result. I guess you can go see a surgeon. I don't know that you're going to be very functional, mm-hmm. but maybe you'll look strong. But if you do the work, then your body's going to be completely functional. It's going to work for you better. And so you just have to go through it and you have to put in the time. And that's what we do.
That's right. And that's why you are who you are.
Yeah, I guess so.
And that's why someone from the virtual audience, I forgot what their name is,
uh-oh.
But we'll find that when they come up.
Uh-oh. So,
Natasha from the virtual audience would like to speak to you. So Natasha, come on up.
Hello, and thank you. My question is, was there ever a gig you regretted not taking, or even worse, a gig you regret taking?
Ooh. Well, I think any time.
Can you repeat the question?
No, you. Oh, me. Oh. She asked if there was ever a gig that I regretted taking or a gig that I regretted not taking.
Can I answer for you?
Oh, boy. I'm scared. So I would have to say that every time I've not taken a gig, you know, sometimes it stems from insecurity. I mean, obviously, if I'm not booked on something else, if I'm just going to sit on my couch.
Sure.
But usually it stems from an insecurity about something that I don't do, mm-hmm. or something that is not my specialty. And if I can suss out that the artist is looking for a specific player and they just don't know about me, you know, and there have been times where I've been hired and I've said to the person, hey, I heard some stuff and I just want to let you know that I'm not that type of a trumpet player. So I don't know if you know enough about me. And I have been told, do what you do to my music. I'm like, oh, cool. Okay. You know,
yeah.
So, but you know, if it's not a perfect fit, then nobody wins.
Right.
You know, I mean, I'll get a check at the end of the night. But how good do I feel about myself that I didn't do the gig right? And how good do they feel that they just paid for me to sit there and not do the gig right? So I do ask questions if something comes across and I'm really not sure that I'm the right fit.
Sure.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much for your question, Natasha. That was a good question. Going on to the next song, we have a video clip. And this video clip is of Kiku performing with Queen Latifah and Trombone Shorty at the White House the second time, playing Preaching the Blues. So let's play that video.
Queen Latifah, and New Orleans' own Trombone Shorty.
Play that trumpet, girl.
So Kiku, tell us what it's like. Tell us what it was like playing at the White House, not once but twice, for President Obama. And if you had had an extra minute in the conversations you had with Obama, what would you have said or what would you have asked him?
Wow. So the first time I was called, I thought, is every trumpet player busy? Like, for real, how did I get this call? Is everybody booked and I'm the only one on my couch? I mean, what? So, but it was kind of nuts. I mean, I had had so much airtime already with other artists, but there was something really different about going to the White House and having the dogs sniff around in my horns while I'm like 50 feet away from them, just in. You know, there might be some weird valve in there or something. I don't know. We got to have the dog smell this thing. It was just, it was mind-blowing and a little intimidating. But at the same time, I pretty much knew everybody. I knew a lot of the crew. I knew a lot of the band. I don't know if I'd ever played with any of the artists yet, but that was taken care of.
Was that, I saw a picture of you and Billy Joel. Was that the White House also?
Yes.
Nice.
Yes. Yeah, Billy Joel was the first one.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So that was really fun because I just grew up loving him and I'm friends with his trumpet player.
That's cool.
So, yeah. I mean, it's just, that was kind of mind blowing. The second time I got called, I was like, oh, well, shoot, everyone's busy again. Let's do this. The second time I was definitely more relaxed, and that was the Queen Latifah shot was from that. And I think it was because it was later on in his presidency that everybody was just so much warmer because, you know, he had infected everybody with his good vibes.
Sure.
And it was really nice because he remembered me. I mean, whether or not he really did, I don't know. Someone probably just like fed him a little thing in his earpiece, but I don't care. She played here before. Tell her, you know, that's cool with me, you know?
Yeah.
And they were both really, really nice. And, you know, Michelle was like, ooh, we're almost wearing the same dress. I was like, trust me, we're not. You know, so they were, both experiences were incredible and extremely different in their own way.
Tell us about your conversations with President Obama.
You know, they were really brief.
I bet.
he's a very busy person, okay? I'm sure he still is. He was so warm.
Yeah.
And they both were. And the first time, he didn't say it's nice to meet you. He said, it's nice to see you. And I thought, man, I'm going to take a note.
I took the same note. I saw him on TV one time, or just saw him in interviews, right? And it's always, so nice to see you.
Yes.
So, and I feel like that is so much more genuine and inviting to people than, you know, whatever it is. But it's like, it's nice to see you.
But it's also a safety.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, I mean, you and I both meet a lot of people.
Yeah.
And we do these we'll do a one-off here and a one-off there and one-off there. We don't know who we've met anymore.
Right.
And so it's so safe to say to somebody, man, it's nice to see you.
Yeah.
You know, and it made me feel all warm and fuzzy. He said, it's nice to see you. gonna cry. I can't That's cry. Cool, my eyelashes will fly. So, you know, and that was really nice. And then the second time he said he remembered me. Cool if he did or he didn't.
Yeah.
But it just made me feel like, okay, now I know I'm in the right place. Mm-hmm. I know it wasn't a mistake.
Right.
And so it was so nice. And actually, before, when I was walking up to the stage, I walked by Queen Latifah. She goes, hold on. This is my mom. I want you to meet my mom. And I was like, I just met Queen Latifah's mom.
Another Jersey girl.
Yes, yep. Exactly. So, I mean, it felt so family style. And Trombone and Shorty, we're sponsored by the same company. And so we were talking about
that's
that.
That's cool.
You know, and yeah. it was just really like a family vibe.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And I think that Obama really helped to create that.
Mm-hmm.
His staff was amazing. Like, everybody was so amazing, and nobody was, I work at the White House, and right. I'm really cool.
Well,
no.
It comes from the top down. The top is
everyone
the prez.
Everyone was so warm, and they really took a note from him, and it was beautiful.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm so lucky.
Talking about incredible experiences, you've had an incredible experience over the past 10 years working with Gloria Gaynor. So you chose the song Reach Out, I'll Be There, and this reminds you of her as your favorite artist to work with. So let's give it a listen. So Gloria Gaynor has had an incredible impact on your life. What may not be obvious to the people watching us tonight is how many similarities you and Gloria have. You both grew up in Jersey. You both come from relatively poor beginnings. And just like you, Gloria was discouraged from using her instrument, her voice. Mm-hmm. Her family had a band, her four brothers sang in it, and she was not allowed to sing in the band with them. Another interesting point from that is that her younger brother, who also wasn't allowed to be in the band, became her manager. So tell us what it is like to be working with a woman who is an absolute legend, but has now, through your eyes, you see her as a friend.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, me and Gigi were, I was texting her right before I came in. And
Gigi, yes, yeah. You know you're tight.
Look, she gave me this ring, she and her manager, it's a Gigi ring. there's never a moment of, I'm better than you, and I know more than you, and I'm your boss, and you need to listen to me. There's never anything like that. It's like, oh man, I'm so excited to do the show, and everything's great, and we'll be on the road, and she'll call my room. She'll be like, they got this big fruit plate in here. Please come and hang out. Who's going to eat all this fruit?
She's inviting you into her home?
Always. Yeah. Always. Yeah. We go to her house. She's been to our house. We've gone to a spa together, just like hang out. When we're on the road, she likes to try as much as she can to build in time, especially with the girls.
Yeah.
Gigi's angels. and so, if let's say we were in Spain one time and she was like, all right, girls, we're having a girls only trip and I got these boats and we're going to go for a boat ride in Spain. And
awesome.
Then, but you got to have all your luggage because we're going right to the airport. It was just like epic things, there's this old volcano. We're going to go to the top of the volcano and have this adventure. And she just always wants to go out and do things and hang out with us. And I mean, we have so much fun.
It sounds amazing.
She's ridiculous. She's ridiculous. And, she's our extended family. She loves my little tiny family. And we just have a great time. And it's so nice. Nice to know that that I'm working for somebody who respects me and doesn't see me as like, oh, okay, you're this puzzle piece.
Right.
Yeah, trumpet player. Okay, that's you.
Right, just the player in the band.
Yeah. I don't need to talk to you or anything. It's cool.
Right.
No. It's totally different. And I feel like, we really connect.
Yeah.
We really, really connect, and it's nice. And we're both Virgos, too. You missed that one.
Oh, all right. It's cool, though. It reminds me of working with Mary J. Blige, where even to today, I'm still close friends with everyone that was on the crew at that time. We have a text group. We stay up with each other. And it's because we just loved working for Mary so much, and she treated us all so well that you develop true bonds of family and friends.
Yeah, I mean, the whole band, we've been texting each other the entire pandemic. I mean, we've been going back and forth, like, just silly little things, or just, you know, sending pictures of our pets or our kids, or, you know, just telling little stories.
Yeah.
And we're all just so connected.
Yeah.
It's really nice.
It's awesome.
It's really nice.
It's that extended family that is just, it's a beautiful thing to have.
Yeah.
Well, Kiku, believe it or not, we made it to the end. Oh, wait, we made it to the end of the interview, but we do have one more virtual guest for you. And the name of that virtual guest is Melanie. All right. I used to have a message. A messenger popped up, and now I'm like, just tell me what it is. And obviously, that's not working. We have Melanie here. Melanie, go ahead. Ask Kiku a question, please. Melanie's mic is muted.
It's going to be a really hard one.
Go ahead. You're good.
But what is your favorite song of all time?
Ooh. Ooh.
Maybe we can get a different virtual guest, huh? I'm just kidding,
Let
Melanie.
Me think.
I'm just kidding.
Wow. What's my favorite song of all time?
High five. Give me a high five. There you go. There
wow.
It is.
Let me think. You know, I have like 1,000 things going through my brain.
John Jacob Jingleheimer.
His name is my name too.
Just think of the first song if you had to remember the best memory, the best moment of your life. What song would come to
mind? Yeah, no pressure.
Let's see. Wow. So I wouldn't say that this is my favorite, but I mentioned it the other day. I'm looking at you because we were talking about my grandfather and my entire childhood. Like, you know, I'd always, if we were going over there, a lot of times I would end up bringing my beat up Bundy trumpet over there because he would always have me, hey, why don't you play a little Down by the Riverside? And so I never ever have occasion to hear this song, but it was the funniest thing thinking about this memory and thinking, right. I mean, he was very old. He also said Turlet, so, you know. But yeah, he was totally Archie Bunker, my grandfather. But it actually encouraged me as a performer because I was so shy.
Yeah.
And I never wanted to play in front of people unless I was, like, buried in the band somewhere. And I'd be playing this horrible rendition of Down by the Riverside on my Bundy, you know, in Florham Park, New Jersey, I guess I'm a performer now. But you know what? Now that I'm thinking about it, it probably is something that did shape me.
Yeah, it warms your heart.
Yeah, it does.
Absolutely.
It does.
That's a good memory. Thank you so
that's
much.
That's funny.
Thank you so much. That was a great question. All right, Kiku, we made it to the end of our interview, and now it is time for the hot seats. Let me get some hot seat music going here.
Ooh, hot.
All right, the hot seat is a game where I ask you 5 questions and you give me the answers off the top of your head. Question number 1, you are playing a show at your favorite venue in the world. It is your show. What's the venue and who is in your band?
Ooh, that's easy. in Palermo, Italy.
Okay.
Yes, with the brass group.
All right.
And actually, it's funny because they have this huge poster of me right now in the streets. They have this, like, art display, this amazing photographer. It just blew me away.
That's cool.
But I always talk about how much I miss Palermo.
Yeah.
And they actually hook me up with a band every time I'm there. And those guys are amazing.
That's
like,
awesome.
I'm not worthy. So that was easy.
That's cool.
Wow.
All right. Question number two. This one might not be so easy. In my humble opinion, trumpet players are some of the coolest players in the brass section. Followed by a close trombone. In your badass ninja opinion, what is the least cool instrument to play in the brass section?
Ooh!
We agree. Just say it.
The slide trumpet? The slide trumpet? I didn't even know there was a slide
there
trumpet.
There is, and it's horrible. It's like a baby trombone, and it sounds like crap.
Okay. All right. So everybody out there, if you see someone playing the slide trumpet, let them know it is not cool. Okay, Kiku, this one's going to get a little bit harder for you.
Aww.
You did say that you had a special dance for every song that you play.
Uh-oh.
And this is your favorite song to perform. So let's see a little of your Kiku trumpet moves when you're on stage.
Yes.
Oh.
Give us a little.
Hold on.
This one? Yeah. This is that remix that I was telling you about. I'm having you dance with no trumpet. There it is. Here it comes. Woo! Give it up for Kiku.
Awesome. I didn't wear my tango shoes.
Awesome. Awesome. Question number four. Holodelic family.
Uh-huh.
You're playing a Holodelic show.
Uh-huh.
I asked the people from the Holodelic this question also. You can switch souls with one member of Holodelic for one night for one show. Ooh. Remember, though, when you switch souls, that person becomes you. So who do you want to become, and who becomes you for one night at a Holodelic show?
Wow. I don't want to be John.
Yeah.
That's my baby brother. Never want to be him.
For those who don't know him, John is the most flexible and athletic trombone player in the world.
Yeah. He rips his pants a lot when I work with him.
Very
and it has
much.
Nothing to do with anything but dancing. Oh, my gosh. Wow, that's a really tough one.
Everyone on the show chose Papadelic.
I mean, that's kind of what I'm thinking, and I'm thinking everybody did that.
Yeah.
Like, everybody did that. All right, I'm going to say... Ooh, I'm going to say Conrad.
Yeah.
Right?
You're going to dress up as... You're going to do the baby Conrad, though?
Ooh.
You're going to drink all that whiskey? That's tough.
For those I might do some water kefir.
Yeah. But Conrad, we can go Conrad.
Come on.
He's a cool cat.
He is.
He's at Conrad course. Hello, my friends. Good to see you. Maybe you're watching. I don't know. That's the beauty of it being live.
I know.
All right. And Kiku, the final question, and this could be an easy one. Who would you like to see on the Spice?
Who would I like to see on the Spice? Wow.
Anybody?
I mean, maybe my husband?
Oh, yeah? You want to step up to the hot seat, Dave?
He's a world-class trombonist. But see, if he's here, then he won't be home with me.
That's right.
Oh, you need me
no,
to come
No, if he's
with
here,
you?
You'll be sitting right where he is.
Let me rethink this. No, actually, I think it would be interesting.
It would be a pleasure to have you on, brother.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm sure I can. My wife can tolerate me for every day.
All right.
So I tell you what, Kiku, that is it.
That's it.
You know, we made it to the end of our interview. I'm so happy that you were able to come and be the first guest for season two.
Yay.
And this is your time to tell us what you have coming up and any other thoughts that you would like to share with us here.
I have no idea what I have coming up.
All right.
I know that I have a virtual concert for Music for Autism in October. I have no idea when it is. But actually, you know, David and I are both, we were both Artists of the Year for Music for Autism.
October 9th.
Okay. Streaming concert, Music for Autism. Look it up on your website.
But it's such a wonderful organization. We've been playing with them for many, many years. Sometimes Tani plays bass with us.
Awesome.
And it's. I mean, when it's live, it's magical. It's a private event, so
okay.
Nobody's invited to my gig on October
12th. Tell you where it is.
Nobody's invited. Oh, but I have stuff coming up in the Carolinas.
All right.
In November. Look, he's looking at the calendar. I love this.
What is it? Is it North Carolina or South
Both.
Carolina? Both. So, as Ever calls it, North and South Kakalaki.
Charleston and Wilmington.
All right, so you got some shows coming up.
I think one of each.
Here's that calendar coordination thing you've been going
what's
on.
Going yeah, on. It's yeah. happening again. We have a calendar.
You got some shows coming up. You're living life. You're happy.
Yeah.
You're inspiring, and you know you're just such a wonderful person, Kiku.
Aww,
I'm so happy that we become friends over the years,
yeah.
And I look forward to hopefully when I put on my DJ Mikadelic garb, hopefully we can perform in Holodelic sometime together.
I love it.
But again, thank you, Kiku, so much. Thank you for joining us tonight. And I'm going to address the virtual audience now. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for tuning in to the season 2 premiere of The Spice. It's been an incredible episode. I have everyone up here. Hey, there's my Aunt Lori.
Aww.
Aunt Lori. And I know other people. There's my wife up there. It's just been an incredible experience. I can't really tell you guys how hard my partner Chris has been working on this show. I've done about 40 hours of pre-production on this. He's probably done 60 hours. He figured out that Club Curious is actually haunted because he was working on the video wall late into the night. So I gotta just say, Chris, thank you so much. And Mara is back there with us again. Mara's calling the show. I got my whole Spice team. I got Mara Beth back there in the corner. I got my buddy Bogdan back there. And it's just the Spice family is growing, and we're so happy. We're coming back on October 21st. And that is going to be our second episode with my buddy Rocky from Bespoke. So if you really, really like house music, that is the show for you. Rocky is one of the, he has the best taste in house music. He throws some of the best parties in New York City. He's a good friend. He really helped Uru out a lot at the beginning of the pandemic. I would like to thank our sponsors. We have our sponsor here, Club Curious. And we have, I'm a sponsor, DJ Mickey D is a sponsor of the show. And Uru Connects. And Radar Entertainment. So we have those sponsors. If you'd like to sponsor the show, just get on in touch with us and we'll make it happen. Otherwise, thank you all so much. The Spotify playlist that has all Kiku songs will be up tomorrow. Aside from that, I love everyone. Peace.